I mean, would it be fair to say that most of the things that are really leading to an apparently positive picture on paper of the economy are external, whether it's the exchange rates, favorable exchange rates, lower energy prices, lower interest rates, QE, US measures that have been taken over recent years, and also could you just comment on maybe the role that the increase in property prices and the whole development of the property sector in the last few years, but the external factors, really, we're just bobbing around on a sea of external factors with little control or influence over them, and that equally we're, for the same reason, extremely vulnerable to all sorts of external factors over which we have absolutely no control. Maybe I'll just start with that. And I have a few other questions.
Sure. Yeah. Certainly a lot of the tailwinds are on the external side. There can be no getting away from that. You mentioned the strong trading partner growth, the competitiveness gains on foot of the depreciation of the exchange rate, QE and so forth. But I think what is most encouraging to me, looking at the data over the past 2 years, we have seen a very robust recovery in domestic demand. Okay, so, you know, not exports, C plus I plus G in the sort of economic terminology. So in particular, I think if you look at the figures over the past year, you have seen personal consumer spending rise very, very strongly. Okay, and you've seen confidence improve. Okay,
but household... can I just ask, just stop you and I take sure. that point? But is that, you know, is that where you just get this? You get a lot of good news coming from you guys and from the government about how it's all going well, which encourages confidence, encourages spending, but is actually, you know, based precisely on that and nothing else.
No, I think if my own view would be that the recovery in confidence is mainly due to what's going on in the labour market. We now have the level of employment 7% above its low point, something like 130,000 jobs, I think, since its low point. The unemployment rate has come down. So I think households are, in general, more confident about where things are going. I think they look and see that the deficit is coming down, that progress is being made. So I think if you look at the figures, you will see a decline in the savings rate when the figures are eventually published. And I think that some of that is due to the need for less precautionary saving. So I think confidence is crucial. And that is supporting very strong consumer spending. We estimate consumer spending will rise by about 3.5% this year. If you look at car sales, over 100,000 for this year. Retail sales running at 6 or 7%.
Have you just on that? Is there any indications of whether sort of personal indebtedness is back on the increase again? Borrowing?
No. What we look at, Deputy, is in fact, it's a very relevant question. I mean, you saw during the crisis period. Households deleveraging, okay? So there was a massive destruction in household net wealth, mainly on foot of a decline in house prices. I think it's about a 45% decline in household net wealth. So households responded to that by accumulating financial assets and reducing financial liabilities. In other words, they were deleveraging. But what has happened over the past maybe three and a half years is that household net wealth is now on a rising path. Okay, so it's actually 35% above its low point. Okay, so I think that's a positive. Another way of looking at it is to look at one measure of the leverage ratio.
On that, are you including in inflation and property price?
No, that's purely in nominal terms. Okay, so what it will do is include the value of housing assets. So yes, sorry, it does include the value of housing, but it also included the value of housing on the way down. Okay, do you get me? Okay.
No, I don't. Explain.
there was a massive destruction in household net wealth.
That I know, yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
And that was mainly because of the 45% decline in the value of housing assets, okay? House prices.
Yeah.
Okay? But we now have house prices rising, but we also have households accumulating financial assets, okay? Stocks and shares and so forth, and reducing their financial liabilities, okay? So assets minus liabilities is your net wealth, okay? So the net wealth of the household sector is one third higher than its low point, okay? And again, that inspires confidence. Balance sheet repair is progressing on average, and certainly there are pockets of very high leverage and there are problems there. But in aggregate terms, household net wealth is improving. But the other measure that we would tend to look at would be the leverage ratio, debt to disposable income. And that has fallen for something like 14 consecutive quarters. So households are making progress in repairing their balance sheets. And with that, and with the recovery in the labour market, they're now more confident and they are consuming. So there is tailwinds on the domestic front as well. Okay?
Yeah, although arguably largely inspired by external factors, but you know, anyway, we can debate that. But just on capital expenditure and the recently announced capital plan, could you just tell me what is, you know, on a sort of annual basis for the period of the capital plan, what percentage of the expenditure we would have had, say, over a 5 or 6 year period pre-crash in capital spending, you know, what proportion is the current plan of the similar capital investment, public capital investment, prior to the crash?
I have the figures between 2016 and 21 in front of me now. I'm afraid I don't have what the public capital program was back in, we'll say, the very bad years, 2010, 2011. I guess it was probably of the order 1 to 2 billion somewhere.
No, I'm saying pre-crash.
Pre-crash. I'd have to check the figures.
Billion.
It's a long time ago. I'm sorry, Deputy.
It was up to 9 billion.
9 billion, okay. Well, I don't have the figures.
So it's still well down. Still well down in terms of previous public capital investment.
If they're the figures, they are the figures. But okay, just in 2013, it was 2 billion. Okay, so it's well up relative to 2013.
Well, no, the question was about the pre-crash period. It's well down, I think. But you haven't got the figures offhand.
To be fair, I mean, in the pre-crash period, that's when we built a lot of the roads and so forth. When we had huge capital needs, all the roads, all the motorways are now complete. Yes, there is need for additional capital investment, but probably not as much as before.
Well, I'd have to say I utterly disagree with you there. I mean, and this is one of the questions I want to ask you. I mean, we've got, what do you have to say about the housing crisis at the moment as a macroeconomic sort of problem? Because it seems to me that we need massive investment, not just from the point of view that people are homeless on the streets, but I would have thought it's going to start to become a problem in terms of even foreign direct investment if people can't afford to live. I mean, average rents now in Dublin for, you know, what, a two-bedroom would be up around 1,700, 1,800, 1,900 euro or more, 2,000. What proportion of that is that of an average income? I mean, that's, to my mind, that is a major macroeconomic imbalance. If the cost of accommodation is, would you not say, is what? I don't know, half or more than half of the average income? Would you not consider that something that we should be extremely worried about?
Just from a forecasting perspective, which is why we attended the committee, we are projecting about 13,000 units for this year. Now, in equilibrium, on the basis of demographics and on the basis of changes in headship rates and so forth, it is estimated that we probably need somewhere in the region 25,000 units per annum. So clearly there is an imbalance in the sector. And that is reflected in rising prices, although the macroprudential tools are certainly dampening developments in sort of the more expensive area. But it's also manifesting itself in terms of rents. And from a competitiveness perspective, from an FDI perspective, yes, that is something that I would be concerned about.
You would be concerned about?
Absolutely.
And what do you think can be done about it?
That's more in the policy space than the like.
But you would be concerned?
Of course, as an economist, I would be concerned about anything that affects the competitiveness of the Irish economy.
Just one other thing. I just wanted to maybe ask you to comment on is the yeah, sure. I've loads actually, but I might come in later. We were just doing a thing today. We were just talking about it tonight in the Dáil about corporate taxation. Have you noticed? Because something I noticed last week when I was looking at your department's study of the effective rates of tax in this country, that the deductions on total profits in 2006, just to give you one example, right, were 5 billion euro deductions off approximately 69 billion in gross profits. By 2011, which is the latest available figures, deductions were 21 billion. Right, much of which I think your own paper indicates were royalties. Do you find that alarming? That the deductions, which reduce, if you like, the taxable profits, shoot up from 10%, I think it is, in terms of royalties, right? From 10% of total profits to, I think I worked it out, or your paper may have worked it out, to 33% of total profits. Between 2006 and 2011. And was that not something that you kind of looked at and thought, this is a bit worrying?
I have to say, I'm not familiar with the analysis. I haven't seen the paper. That area is looked at in a different unit in the department, so I'm simply not aware of the figures, so I simply couldn't comment.